Our first speaker this afternoon is Professor Carl Truman from Westminster Theological Seminary. He holds the Paul Woolley Chair of Church History there. He is the author of numerous books. I think the most recent, but I could be wrong, is Luther on the Christian Life, Cross and Freedom, which is for sale out in the foyer, as are several other of his works, but not all of them. He is currently working with Bruce Gordon, another of our speakers, on the Oxford Handbook of Calvin and Calvinism. One of his books is Minority Report, which I had the privilege of endorsing, so I will read you my endorsement because I still believe it. There is a growing company of Presbyterian prophets writing these days, but Carl Truman is the only one who is clearly enjoying himself. Minority Report is a heady blend, at its most playful when in dead earnest, effortlessly displaying its street cred when dismissing popular culture, and invaluably thought-provoking when probably wrong-headed. This is a learned, urbane, witty, and timely book in the service of Orthodox Protestant thought, and that is what it's like to hear Carl Truman. Here he is.
Well, thanks very much, I think, Tim, for that introduction. Before I start, I'd like to say thanks to Jenny for inviting me to speak, and also thanks to her and her staff for a great job of making all the arrangements for me. I'm sure it was very difficult at your end, but it made life very easy at my end, so thank you so much for that. My topic this afternoon the paper's titled simply Reading the Reformers After Newman. The Newman, of course, to whom I'm referring is Cardinal Newman. Bruce Gordon reminded me just before I came down that he'd had a good lunch, and it's a warm lecture theater, and it's 1 o'clock in the afternoon. He advised me that he'd be unlikely to remain conscious throughout my entire performance. So I will be screaming randomly at points in my lecture just to make sure that he's on the ball. Down to business. The question of the Catholicity of specific instantiations of the Christian faith is one which is perennially pressing. This is particularly the case for varieties of Protestantism. There is a certain triumphalist tendency in Roman Catholicism, rooted in its obvious institutional continuity and undoubted power, which offers a certain confidence in this matter, compared to which any claims to Catholicity made by Protestants seem somewhat tenuous. Recent decades have demonstrated what should really have been obvious to Protestants all along, that a Protestantism which is attached to the Bible in a way that is detached from the history of the church is always at a disadvantage when compared to Rome for those who seek both historical roots for their identity and their theology. The point was highlighted last year when Albert Mohler, president of Southern Baptist Seminary in Louisville, and Scott McKnight, professor of New Testament at Northern Seminary, Chicago, both offered reflections upon the conversion of a pair of Southern Baptist twins to Roman Catholicism and to Anglicanism, respectively. I'd be remiss at this point if I didn't. Tim just described my friendship with Scott McKnight as beautiful. We have an arrangement where if ever one of us is drinking a glass of scotch, he emails or texts the other one to gloat about it of an evening. So I'm sorry that I believe Scott is a Wheaton grad, actually. But I'm sorry that he's not here today. Mohler, speaking to Baptist News Global, commented that failure to teach children doctrine meant that they were vulnerable to being led by their senses rather than a theological understanding grounded in the explicit teachings of Scripture. McKnight, however, considered this to be a somewhat reductionist response and commented as follows, and I quote, "Maybe their pastors were wise and pointed each of them to the great tradition of the church, a great tradition often ignored by Baptist approaches to theology. My own research on why evangelicals become Catholic revealed some crises were created when evangelicals discovered the minefield called church history, and in particular the patristic era." End quote. McKnight's comment is fascinating, pointing as it does to the importance not simply of teaching doctrine in the church, but also of teaching doctrine historically. Doctrine detached from history may well seem biblically rooted, but if taught in such a way, it is likely to raise some obvious questions. Reminded me of a strange personal encounter with the ironically ahistorical nature of some readings of historical theology. In 2002, I gave a lecture at a leading Anglican evangelical college. I'd been asked to speak on the Incarnation and the Lord's Supper. I offered what I thought was a fairly unremarkable account of the position, which I understand to be that of John Calvin. But given the context, being a man of instinctive diplomatic skills, I focused mainly on Anglican sources, such as the Book of Common Prayer, the Homilies, and the Eucharistic writings of Thomas Cranmer. I regard these texts, at least plausibly, to be Calvinistic in their Eucharistic theology. I thus not anticipated that my paper would plunge the room into confrontational chaos during the question and answer session, nor that on returning to the same institution 12 months later, the principal would advise me that he was still receiving letters of complaint about me. I like Jenny, I hope the complaints about my lecture are restricted to a 48-hour period starting now. The reason was simple, but something I'd not anticipated. Anglican evangelicalism defined itself at that point, at least in large part, against Anglo-Catholicism. And Anglo-Catholicism took the Lord's Supper, or Eucharist, very seriously. Thus, the articulation of anything beyond a bare Zwinglianism, even dressed in the idiom of Cranmer and the Book of Common Prayer, was bound to sound like some form of devious crypto-papalism. The experience was salutary. Coming in to speak to a tradition which is not one's own is perhaps a helpful way of becoming aware of this and then of having cause to reflect upon one's own predispositions and prejudices in the reading of church history. The reaction of the Anglican evangelicals was fascinating because it indicated at a simple but important level how later church conflicts so profoundly shape the reception of earlier epochs of church history. That more ink was probably spilled over the Eucharist than over the doctrine of justification by grace through faith or the doctrine of Scripture in the 16th century would be a mysterious and confusing fact for those who read the past through the lens of a present defined by the clash between the Oxford movement and the evangelicals. That's where I thought Jenny's paper this morning was great for me to sort of build on, and that she brought out so beautifully that the sacraments were vitally important to the reformers in a way that I think they've often ceased to be in modern Protestantism. The comment of McKnight and the reaction of the Anglican evangelical audience to my reading of their own foundational documents reminded me of the famous comment by that archetypal one-time Anglo-Catholic, John Henry Newman: to be deep in history is to cease to be a Protestant. Perhaps his single most famous and oft-quoted line. I actually have that on my John Henry Newman mug in my office at Westminster that I take to faculty meetings, and it usually provokes interesting responses. I am the only faculty member of Westminster who has a picture of John Henry Newman hanging in his office. And that, I think, is why they put me in the basement in the far, far corner. For Newman, it was his studies in the 4th and 5th centuries, which, according to his own account at least, drove him from Canterbury to Rome. Yet not all ages of the church might have such a gravitational pull towards the Tiber. One response, one obvious response to Newman is this: the jeopardy caused by history to one's Protestantism depends upon the history one chooses to read. For example, I think being deep in the history of the late 14th and early 15th century papacy might not prove such a great disincentive to being Protestant in the present. For some of us, history, in fact, makes us more convinced of our Protestantism, ragged and problematic as many of its manifestations are. Yet the jeopardy to one's Protestantism, as I've said, depends on the history one reads. And one could also imagine Newman saying that some people's Protestantism also depends as much upon the history they do not read. For it is true that Protestantism, specifically evangelical Protestantism, has often been very weak on history, with little self-conscious reflection on the historical aspects of a faith that is often seen to be the result of a rather too obvious meeting of the biblical text and the mind of the individual believer. As a case in point, a recent volume of testimonies of alumni of a certain evangelical seminary who converted to Roman Catholicism indicates that the lack of history in that seminary's curriculum and their discovery of the rich history of Roman Catholicism was a key factor for many of them. For sure, to find yourself suddenly deep in history when you have no history at all is to make your Protestantism a highly unstable and tenuous thing. It's a remarkable book, just been published by Ignatius Press. It's entitled Evangelical Exodus, and it contains just a sample of the testimonies of people involved with this evangelical seminary who converted to Rome in the space of a period of years. It's quite remarkable and points to something interesting going on at the seminary. And time and again, the lack of history on the curriculum comes up as a theme. This connection to history touches on another common factor in evangelical conversions to Rome, and that is the doctrine of Scripture and the notion of Scripture alone as an authority. Converts to Rome often see what they understand as the traditional Protestant position as vulnerable on two fronts. There is the issue of canon, of the identity and authority of the books which make up the Bible. Given debates within history over the precise limits of the canon, the assumption of the canon is itself something which needs justification. Then there is the issue of the clarity or perspicuity of Scripture. Papers such as this cannot even ask all of the questions which touch on these two matters, let alone presume to offer adequate answers. That's my way of lowering your expectations so that I can't fail at the end. But what I want to do is offer a few historical observations on the matter of Scripture alone, and to do so by using John Henry Newman, not so much as a dialogue partner, but as a theologian who raised questions that Protestants need to answer. Newman is useful in this because there is a sense in which he is the archetypal Protestant convert to Roman Catholicism, and this for two reasons. First, the substantial theological questions which drove him, and second, the brilliance of his narration of his conversion in the Apologia Pro Vita Sua. The work may well have been self-serving. It's often criticized for that, to which the answer is, well, what autobiography is not self-serving? I remember reading Richard Nixon's autobiography in the early 1980s. That's a good example. But even as a Protestant, one can feel the gravitational pull of his compelling prose, his memorable turns of phrase, and his unerring ability to present himself and his struggles in a sympathetic light. It is surely fascinating that it is Newman's conversion to Roman Catholicism in 1845, which has come to be seen as the most significant of such in 19th century Britain. Compare it to the Gorham case, in which the Judicial Committee of the Privy Council determined that the rejection of baptismal regeneration was a perfectly acceptable position for an Anglican priest. That judgment led to a much greater exodus of the elite from the Anglican Church to Rome, and yet never gripped the imagination, as did Newman's moment. The reason is surely simple. Newman narrated his conversion in a powerful, attractive, and compelling way. I would say after Augustine's Confessions, Newman's Apologia is probably the greatest attempt at Christian autobiography that one could look at. It is not simply the literary beauty of Newman's autobiography that makes its conversion compelling, however. It is also the fact that in both his writings and his life, he faced the kind of challenge which McKnight highlighted in his comment on the Southern Baptist twins who left for Rome and Canterbury. The Protestant Newman wrestled with the connected issues of doctrinal development and ecclesiastical authority in a manner we find reflected in many such conversions since. And both of these issues connect to the issue of how the Protestant principle of Scripture alone is to be understood. His focus on these matters offers us an opportunity to reflect upon the claims and the legacy of the Reformation. Approaching Newman from a Protestant perspective, however, is not easy and always somewhat risky. I fear that even thinking about Cardinal Newman risks me being defrocked in my own denomination. But further, there is a considerable body of Roman Catholic scholarship surrounding him, which is so positive about his life and contribution that one recent writer declared in exasperation that such scholarship is not really scholarship at all, but a form of uncritical hagiography. Such may be overstated, but a plausible case for hagiographical tendencies in much of the scholarship can be made. Second, and almost as an antithesis of the first, his status in Protestant circles as the archetypal traitor to the cause, the one-time most dangerous man in England, as the later Cardinal Manning described him, makes him hard to address in anything other than highly partisan terms. Indeed, to speak positively of Newman, or to acknowledge that he raises important questions, is to risk appearing to be about to swim the Tiber oneself. We may add at this point that Newman himself is certainly no safe guide to actually reading the Reformers in terms of what they actually believed. Tract 90 is the most famous example of his approach to the theology of the Reformers. We sought to demonstrate that subscription to the 39 Articles was consistent with the kind of Anglo-Catholicism which he was advocating. In so doing, he attempted to show that the Articles were aimed at pre-Tridentine abuses rather than at the Reformed Catholicism, which received definition at Trent. This tract ultimately fails to convince. In fact, it ultimately failed to convince Newman himself. There is too much special pleading and too much refusal to acknowledge original intent. Another significant text for Newman and the Reformers is his lectures on justification. Reading these, it seems clear that even as a Protestant, he has the same reservations about the doctrine of the magisterial Reformers on this point as is typical of Roman Catholics. Yet it is also unclear as to how much he has actually read the Reformers, and certainly obvious, I think, that he does not really understand them. So to begin with then, it is useful, I think, as we use Newman as our lens for approaching this issue, to be reminded of how traditional Newman's Christianity always was. His dislike of Christian liberalism as a religion of sentiment was profound from an early age. In fact, he declared in his apologia that, quotes, "From the age of 15, dogma has been the fundamental principle of my religion. I know no other religion. I cannot enter into the idea of any other sort of religion. Religion as a mere sentiment is to me a dream and a mockery," end quote. While one must always be wary of taking autobiographical comments at face value, there's no whitewash in the White House comes to mind, this statement by Newman clearly represents at least the impression he wanted to give of a consistent understanding of Christianity which placed dogma at its center. This placed him in opposition to liberalism, but also, I think, eventually pitted him against evangelicalism and ultimately Protestantism as a whole. While Calvin was undoubtedly a doctrinal theologian, Newman regarded his repudiation of Roman authority as rendering the foundations of his dogmatic assertions to be merely a matter of will worship, and thus, we might say, as standing closer to liberalism than to Christian orthodoxy. Yet if we set aside for a moment the issue of dogmatic authority, we should note that by placing dogma at the center, Newman not only automatically relativizes the importance of religious experience to the faith, but also places history in a primary position. For the Bible, to state the obvious, is not an immediately dogmatic book. Dogma arises from the exegesis of the scriptural text and the synthesizing of the results of that exegesis. It is thus of a piece with this dogmatic view of Christianity that Newman was to focus on the problem of the development of doctrine. This concern drove both his growing conviction in the late 1830s and early 40s that the Church of England lacked apostolic authority, and also motivated his composition of an essay on the development of Christian doctrine, the last book he wrote as a Protestant, the first book he published, of course, as a Roman Catholic. This work wrestled with the two connected problems of how doctrine develops and how one identifies a legitimate development as opposed to an illegitimate one. What was clear to Newman was that the pressing question, where was the church before the Reformation, needed an answer which took into account the development of doctrinal statements and the criteria by which a development could be determined to be correct. To return to Moeller and McKnight, Newman poses on this point a twofold challenge to Protestantism. First, that Christianity is dogmatic will scarcely be denied by any conservative Protestant. Yet the emphasis, particularly in Baptist circles, on the importance of experience, that of conversion or the new birth, creates a potential tension at the very heart of Christianity. Is it dogma or experience that ultimately defines the faith? The role of experience in the lives of the Reformers is often unclear. Luther's Tower experience can only be made into an evangelical conversion narrative by doing great violence, I think, to Luther's own self-understanding. Baptism, not conversion, was the key moment in his life with regard to the church. And conversion narratives of a genre do not seem to have been of any great significance in the Reformation. Second, and more important, dogmatic Christianity is necessarily a Christianity which acknowledges, to some degree, the purpose and the importance and authority of history and tradition. To quote McKnight again, soul liberty, which is adored by Baptists like Mola, I think he's having a pop there at Al Mola, leads to soul liberty preaching and soul liberty pastors, who instead of knowing the church tradition, think whatever they find in the Bible is what is supposed to be taught. So first, the reason some leave is because of the essence of his kind of Baptist beliefs that growingly becomes more and more isolated. End quote. Of course, one obvious Protestant response might be that the Reformation principle of Scripture alone should be sufficient for the cultivation and transmission of the faith. It was, after all, the principle articulated by the Reformers as the basis for their various reformations, as codified in numerous of their confessions. Yet if we understand this principle in a radical form, which functionally denies the importance of history or of the institutional church in any substantial form, the question with which Newman wrestled becomes even more acute. Not so much where was the church before the Reformation, but where was the church before last Sunday? Now, the Reformers believe Scripture to be sufficient for the task in hand, but there is sufficiency and there is sufficiency. First, we might make the obvious point that the rallying cry of Scripture alone never in practice stands alone. And we can make this point even without touching on areas of controverted doctrine. It is no coincidence that the Reformation era witnessed the rapid growth and flowering of linguistic studies, initially Greek and Hebrew, but then other relevant languages such as Syriac, culminating in the magnificent polyglot Bibles of the mid-17th century. Neither scriptural sufficiency nor clarity were ever understood by the Reformers to negate the need for learning languages, consulting dictionaries and grammar, nor for translating the Bible into the vernacular. The biblical text was necessarily to be connected to traditions of linguistic scholarship and philosophies of translation. To this non-doctrinal point, we might add that what Newman and McKnight both understand is this: to understand dogma, one must understand dogmatic history. The church as an historical entity always addresses the present in terms set by her past. To take an obvious example from the ancient church, that of diothelitism, the answer to the question of how many wills Christ has does not fall off the pages of Scripture. It needs to be set within the context of the resolution of the Trinitarian and Christological questions which drove the First Council of Constantinople and the Council of Chalcedon. Diothelitism is the answer to problems raised by the solutions offered at those gatherings. As one doctrinal quandary is resolved, the lay of the land and the logic of doctrine are altered. New questions are generated, and so new resolutions are demanded. I think it is not as simple as Newman's idea of the growth from seed to tree, but it is an historical process which exhibits a retrospective logic. And those who are not taught this are liable to be shocked when they discover it. To quote Douglas Beaumont, one of the converts to Rome from the book I cited earlier, "My journey away from evangelicalism did not begin with losing long-held beliefs. Instead, it began as I tried to make better sense of them." It's a fascinating comment, I thought, as I read that. What Beaumont is talking about here when he says he tried to make better sense of his beliefs is his discovery of the history of the doctrines which he had been taught to believe as an evangelical. He attended a seminary which, by his own account, had no church history on its curriculum, had left him thinking the dogmas he believed floated in midair. Such an approach clearly demanded that the principle of Scripture alone bear more weight than that for which it was intended. Such a curriculum is flawed, and yet one can see how it would flow from a certain understanding of the principle of Scripture alone, one which severs doctrinal formulation from historical development. By the way, I should add here, I'm not simply saying this because I'm a church historian whose livelihood depends upon this stuff, but that is a nice collateral benefit of giving a lecture like this. The sad thing about Beaumont's statement from a Protestant perspective is this: the Reformers themselves knew that dogmas had histories. The Scripture principle, which seems to have underlain Beaumont's seminary education, inevitably made Rome attractive because it appears to have denied that simple fact. It pitted Scripture against tradition in a way that is simply not necessary. As is well known, Calvin's engagement with Sadoleto is not so much a debate about scripture versus tradition, but about the true tradition, that which is closely normed by scripture, and false tradition, that which is broken free from scripture. We can debate how plausible the arguments are on each side, but it is clear that Calvin does not understand the scripture principle as detaching his theology from prior historical discussion. Indeed, even a cursory glance at the commentaries and treatises of any magisterial reformer reveals a concern to engage with and draw from historical texts of exegesis and theology. While there are areas of Reformation theology which are arguably novel to some degree, Luther's declarative understanding of justification, for example, is one which receives perennial criticism as an innovation. Much of Reformation and post-Reformation Protestantism operates within the dogmatic parameters of previous generations. The classic creedal doctrine of the Trinity and Incarnation are subject to some modification. Thus, the Reformed argue against the dominant medieval and then later Catholic tradition that Christ is mediator according to his human nature, and argue instead that he is mediator according to his person, mediation being a personal action that can only be performed by a personal agent, not by an impersonal nature. Yet even as they do that, even as they critique the tradition, the Reformed formulation operates within the broad categories set by Chalcedon. The language of two natures and one person is basic. That is not strictly biblical terminology, but conceptual language which has been defined and refined over time. Thus, this is doctrinal formulation resting upon the work of previous generations and engaging, albeit polemically at this point, with the contributions of medieval theologians. In order to understand at any depth what the Reformed are doing, one needs to engage with the narrative of early church Christology and its refraction through the Middle Ages. Even more obvious is the debt of Protestantism to early generations on the issues of the divine essence and attributes. To read, for example, the first part of Westminster Confession of Faith, chapter 2, 1, is to read a statement which is clearly rooted in medieval developments of patristic notions of God. And I quote, There is but one only living and true God, who is infinite and being in perfection, a most pure spirit, invisible, without body, parts, or passions, immutable, immense, eternal, incomprehensible, almighty, most wise, most holy, most free, most absolute. The concepts and the language here, drawn from medieval thought, that God is without parts has obvious resonances with, say, Thomism, and clearly appropriates a concept from late medieval scholasticism. The Reformation principle of Scripture alone was embodied in the Westminster Confession of Faith, but was clearly not understood by the Westminster divines to detach their confessional formulations from the history of relevant doctrinal discussions. This is scarcely unique. On every point of Reformation doctrine, past tradition plays a role, even in the Lutheran understanding of justification. Luther is dependent upon late medieval patterns regarding the nature of language and divine declaration, as well as concern to claim that his position is consistent with that of Augustine. The net result may be novel, but the material and the framework are drawn from previous established theological tradition. Various factors play into this building upon the past, some intellectual, some more material. On the material side, it makes sense that a Protestantism establishing itself within the university context would inevitably connect itself to the past because it would be dependent upon the shape of the established curriculum to which it would have to accommodate itself. At an even more material level, it would also be somewhat dependent upon the established institutional library holdings. Intellectually, the reformers were committed to the notion of tradition, at least in the sense that the faith was not reinvented every Sunday and had been passed down faithfully from generation to generation. That inevitably made it necessary to mine the tradition for insight and to avoid, if at all possible, the implication of novelty, hence Luther's concern to identify his arguably novel position with Augustine. Thus, even something which might appear at first glance to be obvious evidence of a radical scripture principle, the citation of proof texts in a document such as the Westminster Confession is actually counter-evidence to this. I mean, if you were to push back on me, you might say, yeah, but Truman, look at the proof text in the Westminster Confession. Isn't that an example of where you jump from a text ripped out of context to a doctrinal formulation? When you look at how the proof texts were used in the 17th century, however, they were typically not used in a way that made them stand in isolation, representing a simple move from biblical text to doctrinal formulation. Instead, they were intended to operate as exegetical markers, sending the reader of the confession off to consult the commentary traditions on said text. Thus, even the proof texts connected the reader to history rather than separating them from history. Again, to return to Newman, this is where he is useful to Protestants, if only as a salutary reminder of the way in which doctrine emerged and developed within the context of contested positions, each claiming the support of Scripture. For Newman, of course, each case was decided ultimately by the decision of the Church, the Roman Church. For the Reformed, each case was decided by the ability, at least in theory, of the proposed dogmatic model to make sense of the teaching of Scripture. Both positions beg questions with which I am not concerned today. The one on how one establishes the identity of the true church, the other on how one establishes the identity of the scriptural canon and the principles of interpretation thereof. But both also acknowledge the need for an understanding of the history of doctrinal controversy as an important part of understanding Christian doctrine. Failure to do so, as noted above, renders one's understanding of doctrinal formulation to be somewhat unstable. Yet there is more. The Reformers' refusal to allow the principle of Scripture alone to detach them from history also meant that they were by and large corralled in their thinking by trajectories from the church's past. A sense of the history of doctrine and how that history connected to the church as a visible institution provided a context for understanding how to read Scripture. Perhaps the single biggest danger of a baldly stated principle of Scripture alone is that it allows our imaginations to be captured by the issues of our day or overwhelmed by the local narratives of our own particular denominations. Such a view of Scripture alone makes it much easier to reduce the focus of interpretation to our own contemporary tastes and whims, and thus heightens the risk of reading our own issues into Scripture merely to read them back out again in an authoritative way. Of course, for Newman, the idea of development necessarily terminates in an acceptance of Roman authority. Protestants reject that, asserting the fundamental clarity of Scripture. But again, one does not need to agree with the precise nature of Newman's conclusions to see that there is a practical usefulness to prioritizing the concerns of the church as an historic institution over the immediate concerns of the present day. For Newman, the problem of development was ultimately an ecclesiastical issue. This was also, I think, the case for the Reformers. One can argue whether their various solutions were stable in the long run, and certainly Roman Catholic criticism of Protestant denominational proliferation is more compelling, I think, than many Protestants typically acknowledge. But the idea that it is church courts and church officers who are responsible for upholding and teaching the faith was at the heart of the kinds of reforms for which, say, Martin Bucer and John Calvin were pressing in Strasbourg and Geneva, respectively. Thus, I would argue that Newman is perhaps closer to Reformation Protestants than he would like to have thought, and certainly closer to them than many modern evangelicals on that point. The Anglican evangelical attitude to the Lord's Supper is an obvious case in point. An Anglicanism with no real place for the Eucharist is not Protestant Anglicanism and has no more claim to the title than those who find Newman's intellectual gymnastics in Tract 90 to be compelling. Yet when antitractarianism combines with an experiential or revivalist form of Protestantism, the sacraments are marginalized in a way that it is impossible to do with historical integrity and mighty hard to do with any biblical integrity. I was asked in class this year, how come the Reformers went on about the Lord's Supper so much? This was at Westminster, and I said, probably because it's in the Bible. Was my response. I didn't know quite what to say beyond that. Nor will claims of Scripture alone serve to defend such a position, for Scripture itself clearly ascribes importance to the sacraments. Further, a Protestantism which has no care for the efforts of the institutional church, however defined over the centuries, to fine-tool her theological categories and to express the interconnections of theological dogmas in the great creeds and confessions, is doomed to the kind of piecemeal theologizing that is inherently unstable. It is also therefore liable to committing the errors of previous generations. Indeed, to return again to the comments of Moeller and McKnight, what Moeller misses is the dangers inherent in simply teaching doctrine without teaching its history. As I draw my thoughts to a conclusion, I would like to suggest a number of ways in which Protestants need to think about the principle of Scripture alone and its connection to other matters if they are to take seriously the Reformers' practical application of the concept and the kind of issues raised by Newman and reflected in many modern narratives of conversion to Roman Catholicism. First, and here's my own personal sales pitch, history has to have an important place in the theological curriculum. Without a self-conscious understanding of how doctrine has been formulated over time, there can be no truly effective theological pedagogy. Second, given this, there are ecumenical implications, at least at the level of how interconfessional engagement should be conducted. Given the historical processes which led to the formulation of dogmas which Protestants themselves wish to affirm, the Trinity and the Incarnation, for example, I think it is not enough for Protestants simply to repudiate Roman Catholic dogmas as unbiblical or extra-scriptural without first addressing the history of discussion by which they are formulated. The Reformers understood that the principle of Scripture alone was only part of the story of doctrinal formulation, and that the synthesis of doctrine involved a series of moves which placed final doctrinal formulation at some distance from the original text. They also implicitly acknowledged in the way they did theology, that the tradition of discussion and formulation which they inherited from the past informed their work in the present. This places an onus on Protestants in the present, I think, when it comes to criticisms of the Roman Catholic Church. For example, Thomas Guarino's recent, powerful, I think, defense of the Roman view of tradition in his study of Vincent of Lerins fails to convince, or at least it failed to convince me. But it was nonetheless a valiant and sophisticated attempt to justify Roman dogmas such as the Immaculate Conception on grounds which sought to connect the formula to tendencies in Scripture. It is thus important for Protestant critics of that doctrine to understand the dynamics by which it was formulated, defined, and defended, if they are to reject it with integrity. Third, and perhaps cutting a little closer to home for many, there is an odd irony in the claim of the recent confessional evangelical movement of recent decades to be recovering the Reformation, typically on the basis of an assertion of the principle of Scripture alone and of justification by grace through faith alone. That is not the confessional Protestantism of the 16th and 17th centuries, for which more elaborate confessions and a more wholesale connection to church tradition was considered vital. And of course, a return to the confessional theology of the 16th and 17th centuries would practically involve a return to the divisions of the 16th and 17th century, such as those over the Lord's Supper and baptism, matters usually of comparative indifference to evangelical coalitions today. But perhaps we might say that at least such divisions would represent Catholic divisions over things that count. Finally, it is clear that the Reformation principle of Scripture alone cannot practically stand alone. Protestantism in practice was not built solely on Scripture. Issues of canon, of clarity, and of ecclesiology all connect to the principle of Scripture alone and all need to be worked out in connection with each other. Thankfully, that is not my task. I am a mere historian whose job, and I think this is a good job description for a historian, whose job is merely to make things more complicated by pointing to the problems. But it seems to me that magisterial Protestantism might well offer potential in this regard. Indeed, to borrow a term from Newman himself, it perhaps represents a via media between the authority of Rome and the potential chaos of an evangelicalism detached from, or perhaps only eclectically related to, the history of doctrine. Thank you very much.